I'm so excited to be here for my very last Facebook Live in this particular series of really all of these. This is the sixth one, and they've all had to do with really performing your best both in the saddle and out of the saddle. And some of you that have been with me from the very beginning remember that this was not always a comfort within my comfort zone. And I have to say that even though sometimes I showed up sideways and sometimes I showed up on the wrong page, I've kept showing up, and I'm just really glad to have been able to share all the ideas and tools with you all that I have over the last 2 months or so. And I have met some really fabulous new people, and now I really have the ability to continue to use this modality in the future if I want, which was one of my goals coming into this. My name is Jennifer Herron, and I am a business and performance coach. I'm going to be talking today about taking your ability to set goals to a whole new level. I used to feel a little bit uncomfortable about the fact that I became associated with the topic of goal setting in my community, because it felt like, man, it's kind of boring and sort of mumbo jumbo soft skills. And I don't feel that way anymore. Because what I keep learning over and over and over is that this goal setting process is creative, it's exciting, it's fun, it creates resilience, it helps people constantly be moving forward and living fully and having regret-free lives, And so I'm really proud now of this kind of work, and I'm really honored to be able to kind of get the very cool window into people's lives that I get when I help them with their goal setting process. So I'm just going to kind of share a little, give you a little peek into that world today and talk about the process that I've sort of developed over time. And there are two reasons that I do this basically now. One is that I believe so strongly in this process, and that I know it works, and I see a lot of people doing it really badly or not doing it at all, and I think they're missing out on a lot of the juicy stuff that you know, life has to offer. So, and then the other reason is that I want to live in a world where people feel happy and empowered and are constantly growing and having new experiences, because I believe those are the happiest people, and that's a world that I want to live in. So this is my contribution to the world, is to use my gift to help people continually be able to set goals and move in the direction of their dreams. So that's what I do. And I also, before I start getting into the nuts and bolts of goal setting, I want to say that I have accomplished a goal. As of last night, we have reached our enrollment target for the Performance Project, which is my 1 month coaching program coming up May 1st, so it starts in 2 days, I'm so excited. And really, this is gonna be a jam-packed, high-energy, 1 month coaching program that really is, the goal is to help you become more empowered around managing anxiety, stress, fear, self-doubt, whatever kind of gets in between you and your dreams. We're gonna cut through it all. So. I'm still going to keep it open for another day or so, and for 20 or 30 more people to come into the program. So if you want to jump in, jennferherron.com, and click on the Performance Project, and I really hope I get to see you on the other side. So the first, there are two things I want to talk about first before we even go through the steps. Hi, Kaya! Eager viewer, I love it. I'm so glad you're here again. There's a growth mindset and a fixed mindset. If you come into goal setting with a fixed mindset, you're bound to get discouraged, feel frustrated, and maybe even decide you don't like goal setting at all. And what a fixed mindset is it's when you have an idea about the world that things are the way they are and that you don't have the power to change them. So if you have some sort of failure that you deem as a failure, and you look around you and you say, you know what, this is because I don't have enough money, or I don't have any talent, or my horse isn't good enough, or somebody else you know, was on drugs when they gave me that score, whatever it is that you want to blame for your failure, you get to go through life being protected from anything that you might actually be able to change. So you don't ever get the experience of taking responsibility for what you do have the power to change. And a fixed mindset can feel really frustrating and really limiting. So the option is to have a growth mindset. And a growth mindset is, someone who has a growth mindset has the ability to look at any experience and know that they have the ability to change or grow from that. They look at failures as flashlights shining onto those places where they need to change or grow. And one example I have of this from my own life is, I remember, I don't know, a few years ago, or maybe 5 or 6 years ago, I was competing in the dressage championships, our regional dressage championships, and you have multiple judges at the championships, and I had a huge, like, 10% percentage point discrepancy between the judges that were giving me the top score, and then one judge gave me 10 percentage points lower. And it was really easy to just get really angry in that moment and get really frustrated and feel like that judge did me wrong. That judge stole my, you know, championship or whatever. And I started to feel my mind go there, you know, like, and just get resentful and angry. And then I realized, okay, I'm going to sit down and take a look at this test. And it was really cool because I was reading the test and I realized that what a lot of the judges in my career with that horse had been willing to overlook, because he had a degree of elasticity and presence and he was a really cool horse, a lot of judges had been willing to overlook some training issues that had been occurring. And this particular judge wasn't willing to overlook those issues. And that was a real turning point for me with that horse, because I was willing to look at what that judge had to say and believe it and take it to heart. And that was a much bigger gift to me in the long run than getting a championship or getting, you know, all really good scores and getting all those pats on the back. So for me, that was a real moment where I felt that growth mindset sort of kicked in and I learned what was possible by being open to growing and changing from disappointments and failures. So, you know, within the goal setting process, this is I talk to people a lot and they say, oh, I can't set goals. I don't want to set goals because every time I do, something happens and then I feel disappointed and discouraged and I'm just really terrible at setting goals. And this growth mindset is what gives us the grace and the resilience to keep going when things get rough. And we know, or I think everyone here with me is a horse person today so far, we have to be resilient. We're going to have disappointment after disappointment after disappointment. And on the other side, beyond all those disappointments, are the greatest joys that we can imagine. So the ability to have that growth mindset and go into the goal setting process with a growth mindset is super, super important. One of the things that happens with people, they set goals, is they'll set a goal and then the goal will just sort of sit out there. And I like to think of the goals like sitting out there. It starts to gather dust. It sort of gets lost amongst all the other stuff, all the little sort of circumstances of life. And the goal just sits there. And it doesn't draw you forward. Nothing happens. It doesn't give you any traction. And so for me, the goal setting process is also about strategy and about action. So you want to first set a goal, but then you want to have clear strategies and actions that are associated with that goal so that that goal gives you somewhere to go. And this is where I want to make another distinction between a goal and a strategy, because so many times I say to someone, okay, what's your goal? And they'll say, I want to ride my horse 5 days a week. And that is not a goal, because, and the pitfall, the danger of thinking of something like that as a goal is the first week that comes along, and there will be one, that you can't ride your horse 5 days a week, you've failed. And one of the things that us human beings are really good at is telling stories about ourselves when we think we've failed. And this is why New Year's resolutions fail dismally most of the time, because if we take what is really a strategy, it's actually the how we're going to reach the goal, and we call it a goal, we're inevitably not going to be able to maintain that for a long period of time. So really, for someone that wants to ride their horse 5 days a week, what they really want is to be able to, you know, ride a clean show jumping round in 2 months. And the riding 5 days a week is really a strategy for them to be able to ride a double clear show jump round. All right, so same thing if you want to work out 3 days a week. That's not a goal. The goal might be to, you know, lower your blood pressure or be able to run a 5K. But that strategy, the thing you do regularly in order to accomplish your goal, that's the strategy. So, it's really important to not tell stories about yourself. If you have a goal, which should be sort of declarative and important and fixed, the strategy can be creative and supple and wind all around. You can try one thing and it doesn't work, you try something else. You keep that goal. You don't let yourself veer from the goal, but you can think of a gazillion different ways to accomplish that goal. And that's where the flexibility and the resilience come in. Hi, Jasmine. Good to see you. So really think about the difference between strategies and goals when you're using this process for yourself. So if you're not out mucking stalls or riding a horse or driving in your car, I'd like to encourage you to take a minute and write down a goal. Think about the goal that bubbles up for you that makes you feel a little bit excited, that is maybe not too far out, 6 months to a year maybe, or even closer if you want, and something that has maybe been clanging around in your head or something that you've tried before but haven't been able to accomplish. I'd like you to just go ahead and write it down. One of the things that's really important about a goal is to have two components to it. You want to have a measurable result so that when you nail that goal, you can be like, yeah, got it, done, check. And it's really important to be able to mark that spot where you accomplished the goal. But it's also really important to have an intention, a really clear intention around what you want and why that goal is important to you. It's the intention that is the thing that motivates you, that's connected to your values and to your vision for your life. So if, let's say you have a goal of climbing Mount Everest, that goal, it's just out there, okay? I'm gonna climb Mount Everest. But if you're really, really clear about why that's so important to you and what that achievement means, what it means to you spiritually or physically or socially, whatever, that goal you'll be able to remind yourself when you gotta pull yourself out of bed at 4 a.m. to go work out or practice climbing or whatever. So you wanna be really clear not only about what the goal is, what the measurable part is, but also about the intention. Now, I find this fascinating because sometimes the intention is really clear. If you wanna feel a particular way, if you wanna build confidence, or if you wanna do something better in the future than you do now, that is a conceptual, it's not concrete, but it's the thing that's the most important to you. And so then, sometimes you actually have to set a goal, set a measurable result that will draw you in that direction. So if you want to, accomplish, for example, this, me even being here, my goal was really to get comfortable and build confidence around using video in my business in the future, and so that's why I made myself do this. And I wanted that confidence with the video, but I didn't really have a measurable result that I wanted. So at this performance project became my measurable result, that if I used video and then I can film my program, that would both help me get the confidence that I wanted to get around video and help me achieve a goal that has a measurable result. So sometimes the measurable result is really easy. If you want your USDF bronze medal, okay, you know what that is. But why is that important? Why does it matter? Is it about visibility? Is it about a sense of achievement? Is it about your partnership with your horse? you know, why is it that it makes such a difference to you? What is it that's going to pull you through the really challenging things that are going to be between you and that goal? Okay, so while you're, if you're writing down that right now, write down really what the measurable result of your goal is and why it's important to you, why it matters, and how you're going to feel when you accomplish it. Okay, and then the really crazy part that people often find is a little challenging in the beginning is to state your goal in the past or present tense as if it's already happened. This is really important. So an example would be if I say, I will run a marathon by December 5th. I will run. It stays out there. I mean, how many times do you hear people say, I am going to lose weight. I am going to quit smoking. Whatever it is, I'm going to. And it just tends to stay out there in the future. So to really make this goal setting process have more power for you than it has in the past, rewrite your goal, restate it in the past tense as if it has already happened. So you would say, by December, I have run a marathon. Or I run a marathon by December 5th, whatever feels more declarative to you. So, and this is a really hard, we have a real habit. Somebody said to me the other day, I have a habit of daydreaming, and she had a really challenging time actually putting herself in her own shoes in the future and stating something as if it had already happened. And then when she finally did it, she got it. What this is about is giving yourself the experience of being the person who has already accomplished your goal. I have run a marathon. That gives me the experience of the exhilaration and the accomplishment. I know, hi Cheryl, the past tense part gets us a lot. It's a really hard habit to break. And so if you have that experience, then what gets to happen is that, so if I've given myself the experience of having run a marathon and I feel exhilarated, I have this sense of achievement of a lifelong goal, I have a sense of camaraderie with other runners, whatever it is that was my intention, and I've stated that in the past tense, I get to access that person who had already accomplished that goal. I get to, when it's dark and rainy and miserable, or when I twist my ankle and I'm, you know, laying in bed with my leg elevated, discouraged, I get to say, okay, what would that person do? How would that person behave or act or think in this situation? And quite often, you know, when you can access the person that has already accomplished the goal, that's going to impact the decisions you make, the choices you make, and your ability to maintain habits that you might find challenging to maintain. Okay, so that is number two. So number one is include both a measurable result and an intention. Number two is to state your goal in the past or present tense as if it's happening or if it's already happened. And number three is to make your goals really simple and concise and use powerful descriptive words that are meaningful to you. Most of the goals that I help people with tend to be from 1 to 4 sentences long, because it's important to get it all in. It's important that you say everything that's really important about the goal, but it's also important to be concise and have it be something that you can conjure up whenever you need. So declarative, I have done this, or I am doing this, and pretty simple. I always ask people, you know, okay, if they say my goal is to compete and ride training level 3, say, well, what do you want the test to look like to the people watching? What do you want the test to feel like? And they'll usually say, it's about harmony, it's about partnership, it's fluid, it's whatever it is. And those are the words that capture the goal, more than just the completion of the test. So really ask yourself, you know, how would you most closely describe what it is you want to have happen? And use those words. All right, number four, and this, I have to catch people with this all the time, I have to catch myself with this too, is don't plan. Don't plan while you're setting a goal. A goal is the what, and the plan or the strategy is the how. And so often, if you have a goal and you start thinking right off the bat, okay, how am I going to do this, and how am I going to do that, and oh, this is an obstacle, and this is in the way, and I don't have enough money, and I'm not going to have enough time, and yeah, blah, 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 blah. That muddies the water so that you never get clear and committed about your goal. So no planning, no strategizing while you're setting your goal. Okay? And you'll have to catch yourself. Number five is to make sure that your goal is within your control and that it is really yours. This is a real challenge for a lot of us because we don't realize sometimes that goals get old. If we've been trying to do the same thing for years and it hasn't worked, or we have been doing the same thing for years and it has been working, we don't realize when our values have shifted and that it's no longer, that goal is no longer inspiring or important to us. I have a client that I started working with a few years ago, and when we met, he's an athlete, and he had his whole entire life had really hardcore athletic goals, you know, running marathons and that a lot of times involved travel, and lots of working out sort of objectives that he kept for himself, and it was a really important part of his life. And when we started working together, he came to me because he started to feel like a sense of emptiness, like those goals were not feeling motivating to him anymore. He was worried about not feeling healthy and fit, and you know what would happen if he gave those things up. And it was really interesting because he kind of realized that a lot of the goals that he had been setting, athletic goals, he was sort of doing because people expected it of him now. He'd been always doing it. He'd been doing it to please his family or please his friends. And he got really clear about what was important to him, what his values were. And then he made a new goal. And I hope he doesn't mind I'm sharing this with you. I won't say his name, but it was the coolest goal. He actually created his own race where, and I can't remember how long it was, but it was all day long. And he basically ran all day, but he invited his friends and his family to do segments of the race with him all along the way. And, you know, his values were around community, around helping people become healthier in their lives and exposing people to a healthy lifestyle and family. And he got to create a goal that was really in alignment with his values that still supported his athletic desires and his desire to stay healthy and fit, but that had a lot more meaning for him. And ever since then, he's been doing the same thing, like really getting creative about the kinds of athletic goals that he sets for himself and making sure that they are really motivating for him in an authentic way and that he's not just going through the motions. So look at the goal you're setting now and ask yourself, you know, how is it aligned with is it really important to you, and do you have control of it? One example of a goal you don't have control over is you usually, if your goal has to do with competition, you usually don't have control around ranking because you can't control what other people do. So I encourage people to, you know, make goals that are around scores, they're around completion, they're around personal bests, but not necessarily first, second, third place, because on that day you really can't control what anyone else does. So the goal has to be within your power. All right, number six. Actually, this should be further up because this is really important. Your goal has got to make you feel something. It might make you feel excited, it might give you butterflies, it might even make you feel nauseous because you're so nervous about it. If you don't have some sort of a visceral reaction around your goal, don't bother setting it. Because either you won't accomplish it because it won't be motivating to you, or B, when you do accomplish it, you won't give a crap. So don't bother if it doesn't make you a little excited. I was at a workshop the other night and everybody was going around talking about their goals, and the woman we got to last, she was like, gosh, my goal has totally changed, because she realized that the original goal she had in her mind was one that she was just already headed for. It was already planned out. It was already going to happen. And so she had to come up with a goal that was a lot more heartfelt and a lot more challenging. And it brought her to tears when she said it out loud for the first time. And that's the kind of goal that makes a difference in your life, is the kind that will bring you to tears or make you feel a little bit nervous. Okay, so really look at that. Look at the goal that you wrote down and really ask yourself, you know, when you say it out loud and you use descriptive language and you say it in the past tense as if it's already happened, how does that make you feel? Avoid using words like that reference the past, like lose, gain, more, better, because as long as reference the past or even the present, we don't truly get an experience of what we want. So this whole thing of losing weight is a great example. I never let anybody set a goal that involves the language, I lose weight, or I'm going to lose weight, or I want to sit the trot better, or I want to become a better rider. The thing is, I mean, I could talk to 10 years from now, we could talk, and you're probably still going to want to sit the trot better. You're probably still going to want to lose weight. So decide, when you sit the trot better, what are you going to be able to do? When you lose weight, how are you going to measure that? Is it really losing weight that's important? Or is it how you're going to feel when you fit into your size 6 jeans, or you know, when you can play with your grandkids for 2 hours without getting tired? You know, really identify what is it that you want, and instead of doing more, better, less, gain, lose, identify it and claim it. And that's actually hard for people to really lay claim to something that specific. Savannah, hi, so good to see you. You've been on my list for months. So then avoid not setting a goal and not having a time frame, okay, but be willing to move the goalposts. So if you say, okay, you know, I'm gonna weigh 145 pounds by December 25th, if you get really sick and something happens and you say, okay, instead of saying, oh, I'm never gonna do it, here I go again, I'm a failure, I'm never gonna be able to lose weight, instead you say, okay, I'm still gonna weigh 145 pounds, but I'm gonna do it by February instead. So you have both this balance between committing to your time frame and creating and having the courage to create a time frame for yourself, but also the willingness to be flexible and move those goalposts when you get new information or something happens. Okay, that flexibility is really, really important when it comes to setting goals. And this is also kind of a challenging one, is to share your goals with someone. It increases, literally, you go from a 5% chance of achieving a goal when it's clanging around in your head to a 95% chance of accomplishing your goal when you do all of these things I'm talking about, and finally, when you share it with someone. And here's the thing, you don't want to share it with everyone, and you don't want to share it with just anyone, because quite honestly, it's the people that are closest to us that sometimes will collude with our inner critic voice and be the ones that are kind of afraid. They're afraid of us getting hurt. They're afraid of our relationship changing. They might be afraid of that we're gonna do something, you know, too risky and fail. So you wanna think about who in your life has the capacity and the ability and the understanding to support you in a really big way, and that's who you wanna share your goals with. And it might be your partner or your sister or someone you're really close to, but it also might not be those people. It might be someone else who you identify really has the generosity or the knowledge or the empathy to understand where you're at and support you on a daily basis. And having someone who's willing to give you some accountability too and check in with you about your goal is really valuable as well. So, and then number 10 is being willing to change. Be willing to change your goal. If you get new information, if you realize things change, that it's always okay. It's not important that you actually arrive at your goal. What's important is that you lay claim to it and you head in a direction. And that's where all the good stuff happens, is when you commit and you head into it in a direction. And so if you need to change direction for whatever reason, that's okay. And where we get into trouble is all the stories we like to tell ourselves about that we've failed, or that we're not good enough, or that we'll never accomplish this or that, instead of just being willing to say, you know what? I'm gonna change. I'm gonna do something different. I'm gonna have that creativity and the flexibility to do something different. Hi, Rachel, I miss you. So great to see you, see your face. All right, so I know that was really quick and it was kind of a lot of stuff, but I hope it gives you some ideas and some things to play with, because again, this is like the, hi Sarah, this is kind of the gift that I love to share with people, is my ability to help people through this process. So I hope it's useful to you, And again, if you want to be a part of the performance project coming up in a couple of days for the month of May and dust off your dreams, set some goals, and tackle whatever's in your way, jennverheron.com, click on the performance project and jump in before we decide to close the cart. All right, have a fabulous, fabulous weekend, and thank you for being a part of my confidence building journey here on Facebook Live. I hopefully will do it again. Hi, Gwen.